Hi, this is Doug Jackson with SubmarineBoat.com. And you've probably, if you're like me, you've probably bought things and used them, and then you kind of wondered what was inside that made them work and couldn't help yourself but to tear it apart. Well, that happened to me. We made this underwater speaker, and it's a solids transducer, and we potted it in epoxy and attached it to this aluminum plate. It works great. You know, it's an underwater speaker. But it was just killing me because I didn't really know how that was different than a normal speaker. And see, this is the other part of our system here. This is the hydrophones, which are piezo disc attached to that plate there. Thing works great, right? But I'm thinking, you know, if people want to build that, how easy is it to get a hold of the solids transducers? And, well, frankly, it's not that easy. So they come up for sale on eBay now and then, but, you know, they're not like, you know, buying mice for your computer. So, yeah, I had another one. And this is going to be down, you know, one's going to be for the surface unit, one's going to be down on the submarine, and, well, I have a Dremel, too, so it wasn't too much of a deal to just cut through the plastic housing and take a peek inside. And it's not that big a deal, actually, here. There's a coil, and they had some lithium grease on it, and you can see they just have a housing that's made to fit over the top of this, the magnet part, and that coil fits right down into a groove there in the center, and I don't know how much magic that is. And then they had it glued in, and it really wasn't glued in. It had broken loose, and so did the other one over there, the one we're using, because I can shake it, and you can feel this magnet, you know, wobbling around inside, and it doesn't apparently make too much difference, except I'm a little worried that maybe, you know, it would wear against its coil some. I don't think so, because I think they kind of thought that one out. They got this retainer in the disc that it didn't just can't move that much because it sits down in there, and it's, you know, it's a nice fit. So anyway, they had that in there, and then this just, you know, that coil just sits down through there, and yeah, you can see where I cut it apart. A couple of wires connections come in for the speaker, and that's the bolt. Bolt just goes to us, and you'd think maybe this part's flexible here. It's not. It's just rock hard, and we put, you know, we potted the other one in epoxy so that it has, oh, you know, 3/16 inch layer of epoxy over the top of this. That does not move. I mean, not perceptibly anyway. So, yeah, why can't we just do this with a regular speaker, you know? So I don't know anything about speakers, so I thought, oh, it'll tear apart. Well, remember when we built this thing, the amplifier we're using to drive that speaker is out of a 50-watt megaphone, also off eBay. Oh, I don't know, I think about $30. The cool thing about it is, you get this entire unit, you throw most of it away. See, there's the scraps. It has a mic on it. It's a, they call it a differential mic, and it really does work well. You hold it right up to your mouth to talk into it so you don't get the wind problem. And you open the whole thing up, and you're kind of looking around for, you know, what's in here. It takes batteries, so it's 12 volt, and those are just sleeves to hold the batteries apart. You take this thing out, and it's got a card mounted on the right underneath here, that little card, and it's just this one right here. We mounted it on a piece of cutting board, and that's really what we're after here, is that card has the siren and the amplifier for the microphone so that it can, you know, drive the speaker. And that's really all we're after, is the microphone and that 50 amp card. The rest of it, I thought, well, that's kind of a shame, but it has a speaker in there we're throwing away. So it's like, oh, well, I have a regular speaker, and it's 50 amps, and it's meant to be driven by that. So yeah, I tore that apart too. And I don't have many of the pieces left, but look. Does that look familiar or not? This came out of the bullhorn now. It's got a place for a bolt to go back there. It's a big magnet. It's got that ring. It's bigger coil. It had a this rubber piece to go in there. It's kind of like a separator. And then, let me take this apart. It's got a really delicate, and a buddy of mine tells me, Travis tells me that this is Kevlar, and I trust Travis a little bit. He's probably right, because yeah, it kind of acts like a real thin film. That's the part that moves on this one, and it mounts down, drops in just like that. Then it all clamped together, and there you had your, get it where you can see it. There you had your speaker. So my thought is, well, they're moving air. That all makes sense. You see these little rings around here? This thing actually would be given the ability to move back and forth just ever so slightly. But it's incredibly loud when it works. So my thought is, well, we'll just encase the whole thing. And I don't want to encase this in epoxy because, you know, yeah, that's rock. You're not going to move anything after it's in epoxy. But I don't want this exposed to water. I guess it would work only for a while. And I really don't want the contacts or the metal encased in epoxy. So I decided we'd go with oil. Oil is often used to waterproof things. And so I went down to, well, the dollar store and came back with, yeah, kind of like a Tupperware thing. But it's not really. It's a storage unit. So it has a, you know, threaded on lid. So what the plan is, it's going to be a kind of a big unit. But, you know, hey, it's a dollar store. You don't get too picky. We're going to pot this thing so that it's down inside of here. And we may bring it up so that it only uses the... Yeah, we're going to do it like this, though. We're going to face that down somehow, maybe. And, I don't know, maybe we'll just use the whole thing. And we're going to somehow get it in there so it's stuck and it's in oil. And then, this is real soft. It flexes fairly easy. So when we, well, the idea is here, when the diaphragm here moves the oil, it will transmit the sound right through the oil into the water. And this thing will flex enough that, you know, that's easy to get through. And then if we ever needed to, we could unscrew it and work on it. Anyway, that's the plan. We'll let you know how it comes out. Okay, a change of plans. This container would work, and I like it a lot, especially since I only paid a buck for it. But it's just too lightweight, so I've got another idea. You know, we've gone through plexiglass gloves and pipe clamps and other things, but here's what I think we're going to work with here is a piece of 3-inch Schedule 40 PVC pipe, a 3-inch PVC coupler, some cutting board. You know, you can buy this at Sam's. And fairly large sheets for, I think, $10. And it's a wonderful material for cutting and working in the lathe and that kind of thing. And there's our speaker all ready to get put in here. And I got some stainless steel bolts, some RTV, and some thin acrylic. Probably under the plexiglass brand. It looks like about 1/8 inch thick. And yeah, vegetable oil. Okay, we'll see what we can make with all this. Okay, step one, we drilled a hole right through the back of that magnet. Well, I tell you what, drilling through a magnet, it's not actually through the magnet, it's through the steel core in that thing. But don't need much of a clamp to hold it down, that's for sure. Okay, I won't take it over. See what? Yeah, all right. See, I just think the oil needs to be able to move through from the diaphragm. And I gotta flood it back in there with oil anyway. Now the trick is to get those shavings out of that groove. Okay. Okay, I've decided to use that center hole, which is right there, to bolt this thing down. So I'm drilling another one, because actually that diaphragm doesn't touch this. That ring on the other side for the diaphragm doesn't actually connect to the center, but it kind of has a, you know, like a pocket back behind it. So I drilled a hole through the back of the magnet into that pocket so that I can bleed oil into the back side of that diaphragm easily. And another idea I had after fighting to get the stupid shavings off the last time is put some duct tape on there so I can pull the duct tape away and easier get the shavings away from the magnet. Okay, so this is what we've ended up with. You see, there's that ring where the diaphragm sits down in there, and now there's a hole through the back that goes into where that is, a small one on the side there. And the main one here, actually, you know, I didn't drill that. When I got to drilling on that, it just had a bushing piece in there that kind of pressed out. I converted it into a whole bunch of shavings before that, so next time I'll know.